Thank you very much. First of all, it's always a great pleasure and a great honor to be here. We have very good colleagues, but we have also now very good friends, and I would like to specifically thank Ahmed El Rai for his continuous motivation for this collaboration. So I hope I will provide some evidence that today it's really a pity to treat patients with HCC based on the number and the size of the tumor. So the objective of my talk is to present the role of pathology in the management of patients with HCC. And to do so, I will, in the first part of the talk, present to you the way we are currently working by combining histology and molecular pathology and molecular biology to propose a pathomolecular approach. And in the second part of the talk, I will briefly describe the input of artificial intelligence in our practice in order to develop pathomics. For the first part of the talk, I would like to focus on two main clinical issues in terms of classification of HCC and also differential diagnosis of HCC. As introduction, I would like to remind you that hepatocellular carcinoma covers a wide spectrum of tumors, illustrating its high degree of tumor heterogeneity. According to the last WHO classification, 8 different morphological subtypes of HCC are described, which are illustrated in this slide. And in addition to its great tumor heterogeneity, we also know that HCC is an aggressive cancer. And importantly, in addition to provide the histological subtyping of the HCC by histology, histology is also able to provide significant prognostic histological features, such as tumor differentiation and also presence of vascular invasion. However, we should be aware that microvascular invasion can only be assessed on the careful examination of the surgical specimen, because the tumoral nets located within the vessel are not observed within the tumor, but outside at the interface with the non-tumoral liver. And then, to be able to predict the presence of microvascular invasion, for instance, in a tumor biopsy, several groups aim to identify surrogate markers of microvascular invasions. And for instance, several years ago, we were able to evaluate the performance of a panel of 3 antibodies, usually performed in routine by immunohistochemistry. And we were able to show that it's not enough sensitive, but with a very good specificity. Then, using transcriptomic analysis, several research groups identified different gene signatures. This one, including 35 genes, that was able to predict vascular invasion with an overall accuracy of 69%. More recently, in my group, we identified gene signatures, including only 6 genes, that was able to predict vascular invasion with an accuracy of 64% to 82% in biopsy specimen. So we can do that. Additional markers are also available, and for instance, the CD34 immunostaining, so you easily perform in routine practice, and this kind of immunostaining will allow to identify a subtype of hepatocellular carcinoma called the vessel encapsulating tumor clusters. And this paper from Italy clearly demonstrated the prognostic value of this subtype of HCC, but also demonstrated that this subtype of HCC identified by the CD34 immunostaining was much better to different kinds of therapies, including sorafenib, but also in an adjuvant setting with transarterial chemoembolization. So we have tissue markers available to predict the prognosis, but also the response to treatment. In addition to the morphological heterogeneity of HCC, we can also observe an heterogeneity at the molecular level. And so far, six major biological pathways have been identified, associated with a sequential accumulation of genetic and epigenetic molecular events along the process of liver carcinogenesis. And again, by transcriptomics, two main classes of hepatocellular carcinoma are recognized, the proliferation and the non-proliferation classes that are interestingly associated with pathological and immunophenotypical features. And then you can see here the different morphological subtypes I've already presented, and you can see that they are closely linked to a molecular subclass and genetic alteration, but also associated to clinical features and pathological features. And just as example, the macrotrabecular massive HCC subtype characterized by a mutated P53 profile, and the progenitor hepatocellular carcinoma subtype characterized by the overexpression of stem cell marker are clearly associated with a poor prognosis, while the lymphoepithelioma-like HCC subtype characterized by the presence of significant inflammatory infiltrate within the tumor is clearly associated with a good prognosis. The pathomolecular approach is also very powerful to differentiate HCC versus dysplastic nodules, which can be very challenging in the follow-up of patients by imaging. We know that the mutation in TERT promoter, which are the most frequent and the earliest mutations observed in the progression of liver cancer, we know that these mutations are really a key event and play an important role in the development of malignancies. Accordingly, the hepatocellular nodules that will show TERT promoter mutations, whatever their morphological classification, should be considered as malignant. And then we were interested to identify among the large list of morphological features we use to differentiate early HCC and dysplastic nodule, we wanted to see which one of these features was the most associated with the presence of TERT promoter mutations. And to do so, we perform an histological study with a molecular approach, including more than 300 hepatocellular nodules, less than 2 centimeters developed on cirrhosis. And we were able to identify 3 of these markers, plate thickening, increased cell density, and stromal invasion, which were independently and strongly associated with the presence of TERT promoter mutation. Now you know that primary liver cancer defined the right spectrum of primary malignancies, with hepatocellular carcinoma and cholangiocarcinoma at both ends of the spectrum, and in between, the combined hepatocholangiocarcinoma. And I would like to briefly discuss this subtype of tumor. This tumor is considered as a rare tumor, but according to me, the tumor is probably underdiagnosed. The diagnosis of this tumor is based on the histology. Then the histology must show the presence of the two components, hepatocellular carcinoma and cholangiocarcinoma, identified on the routine staining hematine and eosin, and you can confirm the diagnosis using immunos. But I have to say that today, histology or imaging alone are very poorly performant to diagnose the such combined hepatocholangiocarcinoma. And then we, in this study, we propose a two-step strategy, combining first the features of imaging and second the features of histology through the biopsy, and we demonstrated the increased performance of such a two-step strategy for diagnosis combined hepatocholangiocarcinoma before the analysis of the surgical specimen. Again, and as observed for HCC, the combined hepatocholangiocarcinoma defined an heterogeneous group of tumors with two main subtypes. The first one is a stem cell subtype, which is clearly associated with poor prognostic signatures. And we are able to identify subtype on histology, since it has been shown that among combined hepatocholangiocarcinoma, the subtype which overexpress nestin, which is a marker of stem cell feature, are associated with a poor prognosis. The second type is a classical type, and in fact, the management of this type is still debated, because as I told you, this tumor is defined by the presence of the two components. So should we treat the patient with combined tumor as an HCC or as a cholangiocarcinoma? And up to now, we don't know. And to try to answer these questions, we use MALDI imaging, which is a global in situ proteomic approach. And we were able to quantify the respective proportion of both components, hepatocellular carcinoma and cholangiocarcinoma, within the single tumor. And at the end, we are able to say that this combined tumor is much more representative of an HCC or much more representative of a cholangiocarcinoma, and maybe it could be included in our practice to treat these patients. In the second part, I would like to show you the potential impact of artificial intelligence, and I will illustrate with two clinical issues, the diagnosis of primary liver cancer and the prognosis of HCC. You may know that artificial intelligence-based machine learning approaches are very powerful for processing large amounts of data, including data providing from different kinds of imaging modalities. And in fact, imaging is really an attractive field for artificial intelligence, since it allows to perform different tasks of increasing difficulty at different scales of imaging, including segmentation, classification of lesions, and also prognostication. You can see here the exponential growth of studies combining AI, imaging, and liver, and you can see the limited number of studies dedicated only to histology. And it's mainly because, as a pathologist, we have to change our way of working, and we have to move from a conventional approach using the microscope, the glass slide, to a computational pathology using digital image, computers, and scanning equipment. And briefly, the wall slide image we obtain consists on multiple images obtained at different magnification. But to be processed, such large wall slide image should be cut into smaller image patches called tiles. And now I would like to show you some applications for liver pathologists. First, in the case of HCC diagnosis, I've just selected two important papers. The first one, the task was to be able to distinguish hepatocellular carcinoma for adjacent normal liver, it's not so difficult, but you can see that the AI process was very performant, with less than 10% of the tiles were misclassified on the developing set, and less than 20% of tiles were misclassified in the validation test. More complex task was to differentiate different kinds of hepatocellular nodular lesions from benign lesions to malignant lesions, and you can see that they obtained very good performance with AUC values higher than 0.9. Regarding the so-called combined hepatocholangiocarcinoma, two studies, one from collaborative studies led by Julien Calderaro in Paris, and the most recent one performed by Aurélie in my group, and we were able, again, using AI based on H&E stain slide, to reclassify the tumors for the diagnosis of combined hepatocellular carcinoma. So I think these techniques will be very helpful to help us to be more accurate for the diagnosis of primary liver cancer. Other applications in terms of prognosis, several papers showing the performance of AI-based approach to predict survival of patients with hepatocellular carcinoma after surgery, but also to predict the recurrence of hepatocellular carcinoma also after surgery and so on. And more recently, a large international study showing the performance of such technique to predict the response to the treatment associating atezo-beva in patients with advanced hepatocellular carcinoma. And before ending, I would like to put forward the biopsy in the management of patients with HCC. Of course, we know all the limits of the biopsy, the invasive, painful, bleeding in very rare case, tract seeding, sampling variability. But we know now that we can use this histological material to be more performant for an accurate diagnosis of the tumor, to identify prognostic and theranostic features. And then to conclude, I have to say that in the fields of hepatocellular carcinoma, we have now a very comprehensive classification of these tumors with different subtypes that have been described and that are associated with prognosis and clinical relevance. So there are many informative data that can be provided by the biopsy in terms of subtyping, differentiation, and also surrogate markers as already described. And it's also very useful to identify the patients with combined tumor and predict the prognosis of these combined tumors. Regarding PathoMics, I really believe that artificial intelligence is an opportunity and not a threat for pathologists. It allows to perform repetitive tasks. It allows to discover new features that are hidden to the human eye, and it also augments our human skills, especially regarding survival prediction. However, I have to say that such algorithms need to be externally validated for a potential use in routine practice. So I want to thank you, all the Aulbojon Hospital, you for your attention, and I found in my computer the pictures. We were, I think it was in 2018, we were there at Theodore Bizard's, and we had a very great time. Thank you very much for your attention.